I begin our webinar with Nathan Thrall this evening by acknowledging that we are working and organising on the lands of the Kaurna people. We pay our respects to elders past and present. We also acknowledge that sovereignty of this land and the lands across this vast continent of over 250 nations has never been ceded. Welcome to you all, and thank you for joining us for this very special opportunity to speak with Nathan Thrall, who's in Adelaide as a guest of Adelaide Writers Week. Thank you to Adelaide Writers Week and Louise Adler in particular for giving South Australians the opportunity to hear from this brilliant author who speaks with deep and authentic truth, as we've seen, Nathan, in your two writing presentations. Nathan is the author of The Day in the Life of Abed Salama, Anatomy of a Jerusalem Tragedy, which was named a best book of the year by The New Yorker, Time, The Economist, The New Republic and The Financial Times, as well as being selected as the New York Times Book Review Editor's Choice. His previous book, The Only Language They Understand, Forcing Compromise in Israel and Palestine, was published in 2017. His essay reviews and reported features have appeared in the New York Times Magazine, The Guardian, the London Review of Books, and the New York Review of Books, and have been translated in more than a dozen languages. Nathan spent a decade at the International Crisis Group, where he was director of the Arab-Israeli Project and has taught at Bard College. Originally from California, he now lives in Jerusalem. Having listened to Nathan talk about his book, I was struggling to do a 1 second summary on Nathan, but I think the New York Review of Books observation says it best. I don't think I could say it better. A penetrating, wide-ranging, heart-wrenching exploration of life in Palestine under Israeli occupation. I know of no other writing on Israel and Palestine that reaches this depth of perception and understanding. Thank you for your extraordinary work, Nathan. Thank you for being here with AFOPA. And I'll pass over to AFOPA's Mark Khizam for a conversation with you.
Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. Mike.
Hi, everybody. Welcome, and welcome again to Nathan.
Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you here in Adelaide, the cultural capital of Australia. The book you've written is a great book, and the praise is deserved. I'm curious as to how you came to put Abed Salama's story, the tragedy of the loss of his son in the bus accident, how you came to find him and choose that story to have the exploration of the reality of life for Palestinians and Israelis between Israel and the occupation.
Yeah. You know, the ambition of the book was to tell the whole story of Israel-Palestine through a micro history through the lives of a limited set of characters. And there were a number of different factors that led me to this specific event. But one of the things that I knew in advance was that I didn't want to choose something that was, you know, in the international headlines, an event like a war in Gaza or a major incursion by the IDF into Jenin. I didn't want some event that could be exceptionalized and then the focus would be really on that event. What I wanted to do was to show the daily life of Palestinians living under Israeli rule and what that actually meant, and to take them through life under apartheid. And you know, there are so many different NGO reports that are out there about the permit system and about the military court system and about detention of minors. All of these things are central to what happens in the book, but they're dry and not many people will actually read through those reports. And even when you do read through them, it's not the same as walking through the military court system with an adolescent and his mother. And it's not the same as walking through the checkpoint and permit system with a father who's trying to find his son who's just been in a terrible bus accident, and he can't reach half of the hospitals in the area because he can't get through the checkpoints. So, you know, in a way, I was looking for the kind of event and the kind of location that could allow me to tell the much bigger story. And so also the location was very important to me. The fact that it was in the greater Jerusalem area, which is the number one priority area for Israel in terms of Jewish settlement. And it was in an area where you had some of the land where these characters live was formally annexed by Israel in 1967. Some of it was not annexed. All of these characters, they live, all the Palestinian characters live within a walled enclave. 130,000 people today living behind concrete walls, a 26-foot tall concrete wall on three sides, with the fourth side being a different kind of wall that runs through a segregated road, Route 4370, known as the Apartheid Road. So all of these aspects, the division of the West Bank into Area A, B, and C, the annexation of the more than two dozen villages surrounding Jerusalem in 1967, and what the consequences are for the people who lived in the middle of these villages, what it is like to live in an entirely enclosed enclave when you're paying taxes to the Jerusalem municipality and getting no services, and even having Israeli emergency services refusing to enter these areas without an army or police escort. So through the story of this tragic crash involving a group of kindergartners, I felt that I would be able to really tell the whole story of the occupation.
And you do it very well. It's really quite multifaceted. It gives us an insight into the structure of Palestinian society, which was surprisingly traditional to me, as you were describing. Also, you build up in layers the construction of the system, because you have enough of the history in there that a person can understand that some of these things, because the Israelis are the prime movers, they're the ones that have the power to create the system to change the physical realities.
Yeah.
And that some of the things they've done have been responses to immediate crises like the Intifada, and so that generated the war.
Mm-hmm.
But that other things seem to be accidental and incremental.
Mm-hmm.
A response to pressures within Israel, which we're not always aware of the conflicting pressures in Israel from the people that are maximalist, if you like, and the people that are, have a better eye for public relations.
Mm-hmm.
But you give quite a good insight into how things have developed over time, that the system didn't just emerge fully formed.
Yes.
The system is still presumably continuing to evolve now.
That's right.
And Gaza has accelerated some of that.
Yes. I mean, today, first of all, what you say is right about many, many layers to this system that built up over time. And one of the critical developments was the Oslo process. And, you know, Abed is the central character in the book. He was against Oslo when it came about, and he foresaw that it would actually make his life worse, which it indeed did. It led to increased restrictions. It led to the growth of this permit system. And it meant that his job, his higher paying job in Jerusalem, would be threatened because he has a green West Bank ID, and his employer started to get rid of those with green West Bank IDs. You know, the system is so pervasive that at one point, Abed even chooses a marriage partner based on the color of her ID in order to keep that job in Jerusalem.
And the ID is based on where she lives.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And so today what you have since the Gaza war started is you have the worst restrictions on movement than that there have ever been since the start of the occupation in the West Bank. There are, you know, it takes what used to take me a half an hour to get to a location in Ramallah from my home in Jerusalem, now can take 2.5 hours. It is like, I mean, I asked Abed, I said to him, would you say this is the worst that it's been, the restrictions on movement, since the second Intifada? And he said, absolutely not. It's the worst in my lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
It's the worst since 1967. And other Palestinians I've asked have said the same thing. But in terms of the overall structure of the system, more or less what we have in place today is what we've had in place since the Oslo years.
You talked about briefly about the Oslo years and the fact that Yitzhak Rabin, who was assassinated and is hailed as a peacemaker in the West,
yes,
had very clear ideas about what the Oslo Accords were not going to do, and they're not going to give a Palestinian state. And it was a very constrained deal from the Palestinian perspectives. And early on, people like Edward Said turned against Oslo because they recognized that it was, at the very least, entrenching the occupation in another form.
Yes.
Today, we've got Netanyahu not even giving lip service to the concept of a two-state solution, but actually ruling it out.
Yes.
Outright.
Yes.
Can you describe the shift that's happened in Israeli politics? I mean, the Rabin years were Zionist realistic in terms of not really wanting to give anything away to the Palestinians. But we now seem to have a much more aggressive colonial attitude and with a greater indifference to the outside world. And the whole Israeli political spectrum seems to be far more ultra-nationalist and far less interested in the appearance of wanting a peace with the Palestinians.
Yeah. So I don't want to minimize the differences between different political ideologies, political parties in Israel. There are real differences. But I think that there is much more continuity and commonality than one would expect reading Western coverage of Israel. And what you raise with Rabin is a perfect example. So Rabin is hailed by, you know, many right-thinking liberal commentators writing in the English language as this godsend, this heroic figure who wanted to have peace and was tragically assassinated. And that single act ruined the chance for a two-state outcome. And you know, since then, there's been a shift to the right in Israeli politics, and two states has gotten more distant from us because Rabin and his dream are gone and the Israeli left has weakened. But in fact, as you mentioned at the beginning of your question, you know, at the height of the Oslo process, a month before Rabin was assassinated, he outlined his vision for what Oslo was going to lead to. And he said explicitly, it's not going to be a state. We're going to give the Palestinians less than a state. Those are his words. And he spelled out how settlements were going to stay, how Israeli military control would continue over the Jordan Valley and the occupied West Bank, and all kinds of other restrictions, and of course, no capital for Palestinians in Jerusalem. So this was not a state that he envisioned. And so it's a mischaracterization when people today look back fondly at this lost opportunity of Rabin. His vision for Oslo was implemented. That system is still in place, despite the right wing coming to power. And Netanyahu, you know, shortly after Barack Obama was elected president, in November 2008. He took office in January 2009. It was the end of the 2008 to 2009 Gaza war. And Israel was very frightened of Obama. They were frightened that Obama was going to be sympathetic to the Palestinians. They had heard that he had, you know, friendships with people who are sympathetic to the Palestinians from his days in Chicago.
Including Saeed. Edward Saeed, apparently. Yeah.
I mean, I think Rashid Khalidi is somebody that's often mentioned as someone he knew in Chicago. And he gave a speech in Cairo. I believe it was in June, 6 months into his term, where he laid out his vision for peace, and Israel felt quite nervous. And in response to that, to kind of hold off the US and to appease them, Netanyahu did what he's very good at, which is to create some kind of word salad that seemed to appease the US in certain ways. And this was, again, hailed in the Israeli press as Netanyahu has crossed the Rubicon. He has moved toward two states. It's his famous Bar-Ilan speech. And if you look up the Bar-Ilan speech and what he lays out in it, it is almost identical to Rabin's final speech pushing forward the Oslo Accords a month before he was assassinated. Again, the same language, less than a state, or a state minus in Netanyahu's phrase. Major settlement blocks are going to stay. Israeli control over the eastern border of the Palestinian state, et cetera, et cetera. So there has been a shift to the right in Israel. It's true that the far right, the people who are to the right of Netanyahu and are now in greater power than before, people like Minister Ben-Gvir and Minister Smotrich, you know, it's true that, that they have an even more extreme vision. But overall, there is continuity. There is commonality in the idea of indefinite control. No actual sovereignty for Palestinians, and to perpetuate the system in one way or another. Now, there are notions of an economic peace. This is Netanyahu's phrase. There are all kinds of ideas of how to make that absence of Palestinian sovereignty less costly for Israel, less painful for Israel, for Israel to have less criticism from the outside, less pressure from the outside. But none of those things are actually creating a sovereign Palestinian state. And the basic issue has been that nobody has forced Israel to shit or get off the pot. That's the issue. You know, do you intend, we want Palestinians to be free. Do you intend to give them citizenship or do you intend to give them sovereignty? One or the other. And everybody has assumed that Israel has to choose. They have to choose at some point. No, they don't. They do not have to choose. They refuse to choose. Their preference is the status quo, to choose neither of those two things unless they're forced to. And we are eons away from anybody forcing them to. And rhetoric, it will not be enough. And strong statements from world leaders will not be enough. They will need to actually feel that there is a choice. That actually citizenship or sovereignty, one of those two things, is the only way out for them.
One state or two states.
Yeah.
I guess that leads us nicely to your former book, The Only Language I Understand. You talked about nothing forcing Israel to make these decisions. The occupation has become something that they can manage.
Yeah.
The odium has been something that can be managed, and the UN is toothless as long as the US has a veto in Security Council. Can you elaborate on what things might conceivably in the future, you're saying there's nothing in sight now, but what things might conceivably lead to pressure being put on Israel to make the concessions that everybody would say would surely be in Israel's long-term interests if they don't want to end up being an apartheid state. Are there things that we can see that are possible in the future?
Yeah. So first of all, I'll just say that one of the things that has enabled the situation to continue as long as it has is that we're always talking about Israel as an apartheid state in the future tense, if they don't want to be an apartheid state. They are an apartheid state today. The UN has found it. The leading human rights organizations in the world, HRW, Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, leading Palestinian human rights organizations like Al-Haq, leading Israeli civil society and human rights organizations, many of them now, including the leading one, Bet Selem. And so what happens discursively is that we talk about if Israel doesn't want to become an apartheid state, if they don't want to be one. One of the first things that needs to be done is to talk about this in the present tense. We have this illusion that we put forward that there is a democratic Israel within the Green Line and a temporary occupation over half a century long, but nevertheless temporary. And these are two separate things. But in fact, you know, more than 700,000 Israelis, one in 10 Jews, lives over that Green Line. They travel seamlessly between their homes in the occupied West Bank and Israel. They work in jobs in Israel. They're Supreme Court justices. They're ministers in the Israeli government. They have police stations and fire trucks and HMOs and everything in those settlements. You go in those settlements and it's not as though you're in a foreign country. You're in Israel. And so we go on pretending that there's a democratic Israel. There's a temporary occupation in the West Bank, when that's not how it actually looks when you're there. And so what there is one sovereign between the Mediterranean River, I'm sorry, the Mediterranean Sea and the Jordan River. And that is Israel. That is this one sovereign state controlling the lives of 7 million Jews and 7 million Palestinians. And the vast majority of those Palestinians don't have basic civil rights. That's not a democracy. And we are facilitating and enabling this transparently unjust system to continue by treating Israel, by playing by Israel's rules, by saying, okay, we'll treat you. Yes, you are a democracy with a temporary occupation. No, you are an apartheid state. And in terms of consequences, you know, obviously, the most significant one will be to move toward sanctions, and the steps to get there are incremental. It will have to be first to ban settlement goods as the most basic step. I mean, there's just such consensus on this issue. You can be a very respected centrist politician in many Western democracies today and stand up for a ban on settlement goods, for Christ's sake. This is not difficult. And then to move from there to sanctions on entities that are complicit in the occupation, including international ones and Israeli government institutions. And in terms of arms supply, you start with conditionality on the arms, but then you move to actually cutting the arms sales. All of these things have, you know, they're not on-off switches. You get to them incrementally. And that's why a lot of people were very encouraged when the Biden administration now, entirely for domestic political reasons, because the Biden administration is under extreme criticism from young people and Democrats in general for their support of Israel's human rights violations in Gaza and their arming of the what Biden himself called the indiscriminate bombing in Gaza.
Yeah.
They have tried to throw a sop to those critics by doing taking some steps that they wouldn't have taken in other circumstances. And one of those was to impose travel bans and sanctions, economic sanctions, on violent settlers. A small group, they started with four.
Right.
And supposedly they're going to expand it. But these things, again, you know, it's not nearly enough. And violent settlers are not actually the central problem. The occupation, the behavior of the IDF, the entire system of control is the problem. But these are things that's how change happens. It happens with these small incremental changes. And so I think we you know, people shouldn't stand opposed to steps that are insufficient if they are moving in the right direction. But they are happening too slowly, and that's an entirely valid criticism. So I think people need to keep pushing on those doors.
One of the things we've seen is a great resistance in Australia by both major political parties to the notion that Israel is an apartheid state. Former Prime Minister said, well, every country has its faults or flaws. And our current foreign minister said she thought the description was unhelpful. And they stick to the mantra of supporting a two-state solution while they can see on a daily basis it being undermined through settlements in the area that's supposed to be a Palestinian state.
Yeah.
And we've looked at their response to Gaza across the world, I guess, and we wondered why can't they make that sort of mental shift that, okay, there was an attack on October 7th, terrible things happened, people can condemn it, people can react however they want to, but history didn't start on October 7th, there were things before, and history didn't end on October 7th. Why can't they make the shift to say, okay, even if we accept that Israel is defending itself, that what they've done subsequent to October 7th isn't okay, that, you know, the shutting down the hospitals, the bombing of civilians, the enunciation of policies about starving civilians of food and water and medications, yeah, and then acting on them. They haven't been able to somehow make that shift. And it seems that it's more about them not wanting to do it, because if they say that Israel can't do these things, then they have to start confronting the reality of Israel. And it's easier just to pretend that it's all about October 7th. It's all about terror. It's all about, but it's not about the occupation. It's not about the nature of Israel that is underlying everything.
Yeah. I mean, I draw some hope from the massive shift in public opinion that we're seeing, particularly among young people. And my hope is that politicians will do as politicians do. They'll see which way the wind is blowing, and they will start to shift their language in the interest of keeping their seats. And I think what's very important is that the people who are engaged in this issue now continue to be engaged with it after this war is over, because the expectation of Israel's supporters is that this is an unfortunate spike in pro-Palestinian sentiment that's very bad for us, but at the end of the day, no one's going to care about this in a year. No one's going to care when it comes to voting, as long as the election doesn't happen during a Gaza war. And so I think what's very, very important is to keep people engaged and to remind them that this isn't just a tragedy that they're watching on their screens and are brought to tears by, but is one that they are in one way or another complicit in, that their governments are facilitating this. And so they therefore are complicit in it themselves. And I think that that is really important to keep people engaged.
Yes, I think people would agree very strongly. We've seen it before with wars. The ordinary citizen will respond as a human being to the suffering they see, and they'll want it to stop. But once it disappears for a period of time off the TV screens or off your internet feeds, the importance of the issue inevitably diminishes, and so the political pressure on government goes as well.
That's right.
So this has happened many times, and you know, I think you're right, unless it can be framed as this conflict occurred because of this reality that we've been denying and our governments have been denying that they're complicit in, that it won't change.
And moreover, are complicit in the system that keeps leading to these to this bloodshed.
Mm.
You know, when it happens, now there's a demand for a ceasefire. That's great. There should be a demand for a ceasefire. That's the right call. It's the number one priority. But it can't be a ceasefire alone. You know, when the past Gaza war happened, when past Gaza wars have happened, again, everybody called for calm. Let's end it. Restoration of calm. The restoration of that calm is a system of ethnic domination.
Yeah.
And it is going to continue to lead to bloodshed. And if we're serious about not seeing future tragedies like the one unfolding now in Gaza, we have to ask for more than just a ceasefire. We need to change the system that is leading to all this bloodshed.
Is the Israeli trajectory something which is inherent in a colonial project? Because many people have commented on the continuities. When people have described the atrocities in Gaza happening now, other people will say, well, this, you know, they practiced in this. It was done in 1948. Is it inherent in the colonial project that there will continue to be settlements? They'll be forced to continue to move to a more extreme defense of the state? Or is it to do with the fact that you've got a huge number of settlers who've actually gone into the Palestinian territories and who are invested in being there, and who politicians, 10% of the Israeli Jewish population are now settlers? Is that skewing the system, or is it the colonial creation of Israel and that impetus that has brought us to the kind of government Israel has now?
Yeah. So again, I side more on the commonality and continuity end of this argument. There is a kind of description among mainstream kind of liberal commentators where the state has been captured by the settlers. The settlers have twisted the arm of the state. The good generals in the IDF and the secular Zionists who have a rational way of thinking of their country's interests, you know, they have no interest in pursuing this project, and they have been captured by a narrow interest group with outsized power. And I think that is a gross mischaracterization of what has happened. The settlement project is the largest project of the State of Israel in its history. It has been approved by, first of all, started by a center-left set of governments, not by the ideological right, and then continued under all the Israeli yes. governments. And it's something that is, you know, approved by every defense minister, approved by the civil administration of the army, approved by ministerial committees that deal specifically with settlement. So while it's true that there are many secular Israelis in the greater Tel Aviv area who don't particularly care about the settlement project, there is a nearly wall-to-wall consensus among Israeli Jews about this notion that we have no choice. We need to continue the status quo. Now, how many settlements grow or don't grow, that's less important. But the consensus is around continued control without giving Palestinian sovereignty.
And so within that consensus, it's easy for settlers to push their agenda. But the main issue of continued domination, that's one that has been supported across the political spectrum.
40 years ago, in the aftermath of the Lebanon War, particularly the massacre in Sabra and Shatila, there was a very significant peace movement in Israel. That seems to have disappeared over the years. Is there a significant voice for peace in Israel? I know that since October 7th, from what we understand, opinions are very much hardened in Israel. And in fact, I think an opinion poll showed that both Palestinians and Israelis overwhelmingly do not want to coexist together. They wanted separation between mm-hmm. themselves. But prior to October 7th, how significant is the peace camp, or has it completely disappeared in the context of what you were just saying before about the consensus?
So I would say a couple of things. One is the Israeli peace camp, as it defines itself, has shrunk for sure since the 80s. It's a weak force in Israeli society, and it's really much, much smaller than it used to be. I also have criticisms of that shrunken peace camp, because even within that peace camp, the vision that they have for a resolution of this conflict falls very far short of actual Palestinian sovereignty, with a state on the 67 borders and a capital in East Jerusalem. So I think that there's real, it's not enough to just hope for the peace camp to grow in size. That peace camp needs to be educated, and it needs to shift its positions. And there's a lot of racism in that peace camp too. I mean, a lot of what's driving that peace camp is the desire for separation. It's not, you know, we support Palestinian human rights so much as we want to be rid of the Palestinians, and we don't want
to preserve.
We're threatened by demographically, yeah, by the idea that one state will be imposed on us and we'll be a minority. I think you had a second part to your question about the peace camp.
Well, I wondered if it had disappeared completely.
Yeah.
I think you've answered that, but
yeah. I knew what I was going to say.
Yeah.
So I think one of the things you may have been thinking of is the huge protests that were occurring
against Netanyahu
for, you know, the year leading up to the current war, and those protests were about, primarily they were about, you know, the judicial reform that was being put through, and it was in large parts an intra-Jewish fight about how theocratic the state was going to be or not. And it was really that there was a big religious divide, the secular religious divide, among those who were in favor of the reform versus those who were opposed to it. If you looked at those protests, which were very large in size, there was an anti-occupation block within them, but it was quite small. And this was not at all central to the message of the protests, and it was really marginalized. So, you know, it goes to show you the degree to which Israelis can, you know, secular center-left Israelis can have their head in the sands, because the entire discussion was about democracy. People were going on Zoom, you know, classes, you know, all kinds of educated Israelis were going on with expert professors and law and learning about democracy and the fundamentals of democracy and about, you know, what it means for, you know, the court to be undermined, and yet there was no discussion of the fact that Israel today is not a democracy. You cannot, under any reasonable definition of democracy, include a country that has millions of people for over half a century subjugated on the basis of their inborn characteristics.
What about the Palestinians? They seem to be caught between a Palestinian Authority, which was part of the legacy of Oslo, which, as many people describe it, as the enforcement arm of the Israeli state and the occupied territories. The lives of ordinary Palestinians, their attitude, again, prior to October 7th, because that's something of a marker. How were the people that you were interacting with, Abed and other people you may know, how were they viewing the future?
Somehow people around me, people like Abed, allowed themselves to be hopeful. They were sure that this system of injustice was going to end. One way or another, they were sure it was going to end. And they believed that in the end there would be a free Palestine. I was much more skeptical, and I remain much more skeptical. I hope for it, but I don't feel at all assured that that's what's going to come about.
People have asked whether a third intifada might occur. And some people have even speculated as to whether one goal of the Hamas attack was to derail the peace plans that the Americans were hatching with the Saudis and the Israelis to basically marginalize the Palestinians forever, get a state ruled out. And that perhaps Hamas was not just trying to derail something they saw as forever writing them out, taking away the possibility of a Palestinian state. But perhaps Hamas was also hoping that the inevitable Israeli response would generate an uprising in the West Bank. Now, that seemed unlikely. Do you think it was a remote possibility? Do you think it was one of the objectives of Hamas?
It's certainly... Hamas has hoped for a long time, even before October 7th, they've hoped that the West Bank would rise up. And not just Hamas, many Gazans I know, you know, they're being choked. They've been choked for, you know, a decade and a half more. And they're kind of in shock that you know, the world is allowing it, that the world is doing nothing, but also that the life in the West Bank is going on as though they're not being choked. And I think many Gazans are kind of bewildered by what, you know, why are we paying all the price constantly? Gaza's paying this huge price for maintaining Palestinian nationalism and resilience and trying to fight for their rights. And so it's Hamas and among others have hoped that the West Bank would rise up, and for sure they would have liked, and I, you know, I can't read their minds, but obviously that would be a hope to come out of the October 7th attack. And I don't know how far-fetched it was. I mean, a week after October 7th, there were mass protests in the city centers in the West Bank, and the PA security forces were driving into crowds. Someone was killed that first Friday night. So for a moment there, it didn't look like an unrealistic expectation. And then, of course, if and when an uprising happens, every commentator will tell you, we saw it coming, it was going to happen. You know, it's inevitable. Of course, the West Bank was going to rise up. So I think there is an expectation people won't endure this forever, and that there will be more resistance in the West Bank.
Armed resistance has been building in the West Bank. I mean, we've had particularly places like Jenin, centres of resistance, where people have again resumed to armed resistance against the occupation. And the year, the months leading up to October 7th, I think there was over 250 people killed in the West Bank by the military, not all of them armed, but there was a significant increase in that type of resistance.
More than 400 since October 7th.
Yes. So subsequent to October 7th, the Israelis have felt that they have a free rein to both pursue people planning armed resistance, but basically they don't seem to be too worried about who they kill.
A free rein also to massively increase the forced displacement that they're doing. I mean, over 1,000 Palestinians were forcibly displaced, mostly from Area C in the West Bank, in the year prior or year and a half prior to October 7th. And then just in the month after October 7th, that many more, another 1,000, more than 1,000 were forcibly displaced.
Under the cover of the world looking at the war in Gaza.
That's right.
What about in Gaza itself? You went there many years ago. How much time have you spent in Gaza?
So my first work for the International Crisis Group was living in Gaza and reporting in Gaza. For a sustained period for a month and a half, and then another several week trip. And then since then, I've gone back and forth all the time. Every few weeks, I would go to Gaza, and I have one of my closest friends and colleagues lives in Gaza. I'd stay at his home in Gaza City. He's now in Rafah. He's been displaced. I've lost count of how many times he's moved from one location to another with his family. He is desperate to get his family out, and it's impossible. We have tried everything. He has more connections than 99% of people in Gaza. He doesn't have a foreign passport, and we have tried, and the International Crisis Group, I no longer work there, but he still works there. They have tried with all kinds of foreign governments, with the U.S. government escalating to very high levels, and have received all kinds of promises, and all of them come back and say, Israel won't let him leave. Israel won't let him certainly leave, not because of him. Israel has no security file on him. He would exit Gaza and come and stay in my home. He had multiple exit passes. There was no security issue with him because they're not letting anybody leave. And, there's all of this talk now among right-wing Israeli ministers of, well, let's plan to do voluntary transfer to pay them to leave. It's all nonsense. The reality is, there are many, many, many Gazans who are desperate to leave. And cannot.
When people have looked at Israel's attack on Gaza, one of the things that is often put up is the belief that the Israeli government is attempting a second Nakba, that they actually are not just interested in revenge, not just interested in avenging the humiliation of the successful Hamas attack on the Israeli military on October 7th. But that it's a desire for ethnic cleansing.
Yeah.
And that the way they conducted the war, moving steadily from north to south, destroying everything, is consistent with that. They're not leaving any basis for human societies in the areas they've gone. I remember seeing one report, it looked like a clip out of the first Terminator film.
Absolutely.
You know, massive machinery and soldiers in a landscape of just rubble.
Yes.
Why don't they open the borders if it's on the cards, at least for some parts of the Israeli government, that ethnic cleansing would be a neat solution? Yeah. Why don't they open the borders?
So first of all, I think if ethnic cleansing has already happened, I mean, over 1.5 million Gazans have been encouraged to leave their homes, and their homes are destroyed,
mm-hmm.
and they have no place to go back to. So 1.5 million people have been forced out of the northern part of Gaza and the now the center and Khan Yunis and are in Rafah. And so all of those areas have been depopulated of Palestinians, and their homes are gone. 70% of the structures in Gaza are destroyed. What would Israel like all 2.2, 2.3 million people in Gaza to just disappear, to, you know, migrate somewhere else? They would love it. They would love it if they thought that they could do it. But they don't feel that they can. They don't think they can get away with it. They don't think that they can keep their relations with Egypt if they start. I mean, it's physically they can do it. They can start bombing. You know, they at one point in the war they did bomb the Rafah crossing. They could bomb a few places along the border with Egypt and then start bombing southward from Khan Yunis, and they could get a flood going south. But they believe that they'll lose the peace treaty with Egypt and all kinds of other very, very negative repercussions for them. So it's a matter of they don't think that they can get away with it.
So what is the Israeli government after? They talk about the necessity to destroy Hamas completely.
Yeah.
And they at the same time they say their enemy is not the Palestinian people, while doing everything that makes it obvious that they're targeting the civilian population. But the destruction of Hamas is being pursued at whatever cost to the civilian population. Why do they need the total destruction of Hamas, given that the worst that Hamas has been able to do prior to October 7th, which was essentially a successful border military operation, which was dealt with in a few days by the Israeli military, the worst that Hamas has been able to do is send masses of rockets, which rarely have any impact in terms of civilian casualties in Israel. Why the necessity for having to destroy Hamas?
So their stated aim of eliminating Hamas cannot be achieved, and they know it. And Hamas can be degraded. They can kill many more people in Gaza, including Hamas fighters. They can occupy Gaza indefinitely, but they can't eliminate Hamas, which is their stated objective. And we see that even in the north, where they claimed months ago, they claimed to have achieved their objectives and defeated Hamas in the north. And what has happened in the north is, first of all, Israeli body bags keep coming from the north. They haven't actually defeated Hamas, even militarily, in the north. And I'm sure that the Hamas force in the north is, you know, nothing compared to what it was. But nevertheless, there are Israeli soldiers who keep dying in the north months after Israel claimed that a mission accomplished in the north. And in addition, who has come out into the markets in Jabalia and areas in the north to try and create some sense of order, to try and help people who are starving in the north? It's members of the former Hamas government in Gaza. And Hamas is the force that's going to be on the ground that will reemerge when Israeli soldiers disappear in all parts of Gaza. And this whole notion that Israel is going to get a multinational force to come in and control Gaza, or they're going to get the PA security forces to control Gaza, or which they know they say they don't want, but all of this is a fantasy. Hamas will remain a very strong power in Gaza, whether they do an operation in Rafah or they don't do an operation in Rafah. When Israeli forces leave, it's going to be Hamas that's there. And you can have a fig leaf, some other government, a technocrat or whatever government in place there that is the face of the Gaza government to the world, but behind the scenes, Hamas will be the power on the ground in Gaza.
So Hamas has a resilience. You can perhaps look at the reasons for that, but why was Israel so intent on the siege and the destruction of Hamas even before October 7th? What is qualitatively different about Hamas from the PLO or the Palestinian Authority that the Israeli government feels they need to retain them as the ultimate enemy? Is it something about Hamas as a movement? Is it about the fact that Israel has regional ambitions and Hamas is aligned with Iran, and Iran is an obstacle to Israeli regional dominance? What is it? What's so special about Hamas that they have had this fixation on destroying Hamas before October 7th?
Yeah. Well, in Hamas is a resistance organization. They're committed to armed resistance, and Israel is committed to destroying all resistance organizations. When there's a resistance organization in Nablus that emerges and calls itself the Lion's Den, Israel goes and tries to destroy it. When, you know, Fatah wants to fight from Jenin, Israel will go and fight Fatah militias. So there's a consistency. I mean, Israel is trying to destroy any resistance organization, and Hamas is the biggest and main one. That said, you know, it's important to know that this isolation of Gaza and this enclosure of Gaza long precedes Hamas rule there. I mean, the first fence around Gaza went up in the early 90s, and the first restrictions on Gazans not being able to go and enter Israel, that's from the 90s. This is all long before Hamas. So you know, what Gaza represents is a massive Palestinian population center, especially threatening because there are many refugees among them, which Israel has always felt more threatened by because they have claims to the land that Israelis are and the homes that Israelis are living in. So it represents a massive Palestinian population center, and the basic policy of Israel is for them to have maximal land with minimal Palestinians on it. So when you have many, many Palestinians in a small, relatively small piece of land, you wall them off, and you wall off the people who live in Shuafat camp within Jerusalem, the mothers and fathers in this book. They live within Jerusalem, within the municipality of Jerusalem. When it's time to build that wall, they don't follow the municipal line. They go and they carve it in order to keep as many Palestinians out as they can without relinquishing too much land.
Nathan Thrall, thank you. It's been a very interesting discussion, and thank you for being part of it.
Thank you for having me.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for joining us.